Good evening. This is Thursday, September 14th, 54 days until the 2006 midterm elections. It was President Bush's calculation that because of that election, a Republican-controlled Congress would not dare deny him the power to detain and interrogate terror suspects in any manner he sees fit. Our fifth story on the countdown tonight, the president just flunked calculus. Three powerful Senate Republicans, not to mention the former Secretary of State, who carried the water about Iraq to the United Nations, all spurning the White House over its plan for prosecuting and interrogating detainees at Guantanamo Bay, and initially at least beating that plan. The president putting in some FaceTime on Capitol Hill today, evidently in vain. He made his case for legislation that would, among other things, rewrite a key provision of the Geneva Conventions known as Common Article 3, the one that prohibits the cruel and inhuman treatment of detainees. You will recall that earlier this summer, the Supreme Court ruled the Bush administration must meet Article 3 standards in its handling of terror suspects. But the Senate Foreign Relations Committee voting this afternoon for its own version of the detainee bill, one that it says protects the rights of suspects, thus leaving many key provisions of the Bush plan out. The bill, championed and largely written by Republican Senators McCain, Warner, and Graham, Senator Graham himself still a reserve judge in the Air Force Court of Appeals. Every Democrat on the committee supporting the bill, along with the Republican Susan Collins of Maine, the vote 15-9. Former Secretary of State Powell, former Joint Chiefs of Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff as well, voicing his opposition in a letter to Senator McCain released this morning that any changes to Article 3 could adversely affect the treatment of captured American soldiers. Quoting General Powell, "The world is beginning to doubt the moral basis of our fight against terrorism. To redefine common Article 3 would add to those doubts. Furthermore, it would put our own troops at risk." The administration's response to its Republican critics, simple and simply predictable and extraordinarily familiar, they must be confused.
Do you think that Colin Powell, a former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, is just confused about what you're trying to do?
Yes.
And you think that he would write a letter like this without an understanding?
I don't know. It's interesting. We didn't hear from him, so I don't know.
Well, how do you account for the fact that three Republican senators oppose you so vehemently on this?
It's a free country. You're allowed to oppose, and what I'm suggesting is that they're still on and prejudge.
Critics of this, Republicans that you've talked about, think that you are seeking to alter Article 3 because you are in effect lowering the standards of Article 3 by the elimination of this
No, it's a straw man. As a matter of fact, what we're trying to do is we're trying to reach out and work with them to come up with the issues.
But you're defining it in a way that does not address outrages upon personal dignity, in particular
sure
humiliating and degrading treatment, because you find that to be vague.
No, all of it is vague, and therefore what you do is you try to provide some clarity by saying, here are the subset of behaviors that we think fall under those terms. I think we're talking past each other here.
You're certainly talking past the people who oppose you, you can help the country understand, because I can't imagine this is clear.
Okay, well, I don't even understand the question. What exactly is it?
You claim, all right, I'll restate the question. You claim that you are not redefining Article 3. Everyone who opposes you on this, from Secretary Powell to Senator Warner to Senator Graham to Senator McCain, says, in effect, you are trying to redefine it by excluding language you consider vague that they think is important.
Thank you. That's okay. Thank you. No, we're not excluding it. We're defining what that language means. Oh, heart be still.
You do not address the language that you think is vague, which is in Article 3 now, which has with outrages.
No, you do. No, I don't know how I can make it clearer. What you do is you say...
You can, Tony. I mean, you may think I just don't get it, but...
I do.
Suggest to you that if I don't get it, then I bet there's a lot of people who don't get it as well.
As his boss, President Bush, had made it before him, Mr. Snow also claiming today that the CIA's interrogation of detainees had led to the breakup of at least eight specific purported terror plots. But even as the White House is arguing over what it should be allowed to do to the terror suspects it already has, comes word from Mr. Bush himself that he does not even care if Osama bin Laden is ever captured. The president telling conservative pundit Fred Barnes in an interview that emphasis on bin Laden does not fit with the administration's strategy for combating terrorism, saying that the terror leader's capture would not be the best use of America's resources. Mr. Bush adding that he has never been more convinced that the decisions he has made as president are the right decisions. The Bush administration also facing a challenge from the Nuclear Watchdog Agency of the United Nations over the evidence it is choosing to cite about Iran's nuclear capabilities. The IAEA complaining to the Bush administration and to a Republican congressman about a recent House committee report calling parts of the document outrageous and dishonest for containing some, quote, erroneous, misleading, and unsubstantiated statements. You may recall that the IAEA openly clashed with the administration on pre-war assessments of Saddam Hussein's weapons of mass destruction. Former nuclear inspector David Kaye saying now, quote, this is like pre-war Iraq all over again. Earlier this week, when asked by NBC's Matt Lauer if he had a smoking gun proving that the Iranians are enriching uranium, the president cited what he called compelling evidence from the IAEA of an illegal Iranian enrichment program. And now to call in our own Craig Crawford, who's, of course, also a columnist for Congressional Quarterly. Craig, good evening.
Hi. So now we know you've been confused all this time.
The percentage of confused is up to about 93 at this point. Last week, when Mr. Bush challenged Congress to do things his way on Guantanamo and on the handling of the terror suspect, we were wondering if he was trying to squeeze the Democrats or squeeze his own Republicans. Well, now we know, and the Republicans just squeezed back hard, did they not?
They certainly did. You know, this president's always approached Capitol Hill, even his own party leaders on Capitol Hill, much as Lyndon Johnson once did when he said, come let us reason together, boys, and do it my way. Except that Lyndon Johnson had a long history on the Hill. He knew all their secrets, and he was able to cajole the votes he needed. This president has oddly, and this is one of the strangest things about this president, I've thought all along, at how he has just not really shown much interest at building personal relationships on Capitol Hill with his own party members. And that has led to a lot of these problems, like we saw today, where they buck on him, and that's something that I don't think he can change now. It's too late.
It's not as if the argument over this is not important enough on its face. I mean, golly, if we rewrite the Geneva Convention, could not our enemies rewrite the Geneva Convention and torture our prisoners as they see fit? But is there something even bigger in terms of domestic politics? Three Republican Senate heavyweights, Colin Powell, oppose the president. Tony Snow calls Powell confused. Did the president just throw away the political protection of partisanship? Did he just lose part of the Republican Party?
Yes, and I do see an interesting byproduct here, Keith, that could actually help the Republicans. Not that they designed it this way or that it's choreographed, but that it does help a lot of these Republicans running out here in the congressional elections coming up to show a little distance with this president. It's not good for the party to be seen as in lockstep with the president. So in a weird twist, it might actually help the president's party for them to have just a little bit of a riff here and there to show voters that they are independent actors, the Republicans on Capitol Hill. So then maybe they pick up a few of those votes that lean conservative, lean Republican, but have problems with Bush. No. Could happen.
Not necessarily a good thing for the government or the country, but you might be right about this. But,
well, yeah, that's a lesser matter in election season.
I guess. Not just Mr. Snow's response today, but the administration's tone lately, the last 3-4 weeks. If you disagree with us, you are confused. How far can they ride confusion? Could the president say the Supreme Court's confused, voters confused, date of the next presidential inaugural is confused? Is this not a slippery slope if ever there was one?
Yeah, well, you know, those poor founding fathers back in the hot summer of Philadelphia in 1787, maybe right. They were confused when they came up with all these crazy individual liberties. But the president, it does have this attitude that, you know, it's my way or the highway. And it always was okay so long as he had, you know, 60-70% of the public behind him. What he's found is that, you know, now he doesn't have those relationships on the Hill to get him through these tough times.
I assume you're omniscient. If I'm wrong, please correct me. last question about bin Laden. Mr. Bush was claiming this past Monday, 9/11, no matter how long it takes, America will find you and we'll bring you to justice. What happened?
I just wonder what they might say if maybe next week or come October they find bin Laden. Suddenly that will be a very big deal. Maybe that's their thinking, is that they try to get bin Laden off the table because maybe they've given up on finding him. One thing's for sure, for 5 years at least, he's been able to run and he's been able to hide.
Well, after Pakistan made the deal with the warlords in the area where he's supposedly hiding, I suppose it's probably good to quit while you're behind. Craig Crawford of Congressional Quarterly and of MSNBC. It all just keeps getting better and better. Thanks, Craig.
Yeah, thanks.